My goodness. Well, behold the Lamb. He's here.
Amen.
He's here. Glory to God. He's here. Mm-mm-mm. You know, you've come for a reason, as Cindy was saying. We've come for a reason. I don't want you to go home empty-handed.
Amen.
I want you to go with what you've come for. And what I hope you've come for is an encounter with the living God that will absolutely you don't even know what to do because he's so fantastic and so marvelous. He loves you. He knows you. He cares about you. He's not mad with you. First time I ever heard that statement was T.L. Osborne, who said that statement years ago down at John Osteen's church. Years ago, and Brother T.L. Osborne was speaking. And I thought it was the most wonderful thing I'd ever heard in my life when he said that God's not mad with you. Because I had every reason in the world to believe he was mad. Have you ever felt that way? I mean, I thought he had to be mad with me. And then you look at you and I thought he ought to be mad with you. Don't look so holy now. Don't look so holy. Try to walk with me through this thing, okay? Now, I believe tonight that at any point, just something miraculous is going to happen. And we want to honor him and praise him and exalt him and give him glory and let him do what he's so good at doing, just being who he is. He loves you. He cares about you. So I'm going to try to go back and walk you through some things that are very simple principles. And then we're going to just give the show over to him. How about it?
Amen.
All right, if you have your Bible, let's go to several different places. And I want to talk to you about everything's going to be all right.
Amen.
Look at your neighbor and say, everything's going to be all right.
Amen.
Tell them again, everything's going to be all right.
Everything's going to be all right.
Now, if you got a Bible, we want you to follow me. If you don't, we'll give you one that you can use. Anybody need a Bible? If you're sick, you need one. If you need a Bible, we want to loan you one. So just slip your hands up and we'll give you one. If you don't have one, just take it. Hallelujah. Just keep it. We don't care. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. But if you need a Bible, you need to see what God's Word says. Because you'll learn faster seeing and hearing. You need to see that what I'm saying, I didn't make it up. You need to see it's in the Word of God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. One day it would be fun, Velda, just to kind of figure out how many of these we have done. How many healing explosions. I mean, thousands, I am sure, over the years. But it's just, and seeing God do so many things, and never yet have I ever taught the same message twice. Ever. Ever. It's just amazing to me. If you have your Bibles now, I'm going to send you over to, I think, Hebrews, and you just wonder where I'm going when you get there. And I'm going to talk a minute or two about John and just point out some things to you before we jump on Hebrews. But everything's going to be, the Lord said to me, everything's going to be all right. Now, I say that all the time, and I'll tell you why I say it all the time. I'm going to bring it in the message. You can ask anybody here, and I will say to them, everything's going to be all right. Everything's going to be all right. So, but let me show you a couple of things before I go and show you why I do that. In John chapter 4, you don't have to go there. I'm going to read it to you. In John chapter 4, beginning in verse 48, that scripture in John chapter 4 comes out of one of my favorite stories in the Bible. And I've done many messages on it when it has to do with the Lord healing the official son. This guy, to me, he just amazes me, so I don't want to get off on him, but he amazes me because he's the nobleman who came and said his son was dying, and he walked for a couple of days to get there, and then he gets there, and then Jesus basically doesn't say anything. One of the first things he says is the verse I'm reading to you, verse 48. Jesus said unto him, except you see signs and wonders, you will not believe. Unless you see signs and wonders, you will not believe. There are folks in here tonight who will not believe until you see a sign and wonder. You will sit there and wonder what's going on. And if I have a healing line, which I probably will, if I have a healing line, and then If you see everybody standing, you'll sit back kind of. But if you see people begin to fall and hit the floor, you'll get up and get in the line. Right. Not because you want to fall and hit the floor. Matter of fact, you're going to make sure you don't. You're going to turn around most of it, make sure somebody's going to catch you. You know me, I tell it straight. And you can't tell me you're in great faith when you turn around to make sure you're in the right position for them to get you before you hit the floor. Because you planned it ahead of time. Are you with me? And so, but I guarantee you, I've seen it so many times. You go down, you lay hands on people, and everybody remains standing, and you just keep going. And people have a tendency not to come. But when they start falling, whoa! I mean, you'll see them sneaking around, getting in line. You think you're through praying, you turn around, you got another whole line. And if they all fall out, you got another whole line. Then they down the aisle. And yet, falling has nothing to do with whether you get healed or not. And it fits in this particular scripture, you know, where it says, except you see signs and wonders, you're not going to believe. You'll sit here and say, there's no power. She ain't got the power tonight. Nothing's happening tonight. Look at her. Must be gone. The point of this, don't let physical senses dictate whether you believe or not. Amen. Now, that's a major principle you need to hear tonight. Because I don't know what God's going to do, but you need to hear that. You need to hear that. Don't let your physical senses determine what you believe. Whether something shoots through you and you go, ooh, you know, or whether, you know, whatever it is, or if you just stand there and feel absolutely nothing, that has nothing to do whether God has touched you or not. So that's the first thing I want you to know. And the thing so great about this nobleman, if you read the story, maybe you will later, you know, the Lord didn't really give him much to go on. He just told him to go home. His son was going to live. And the guy had to leave with no, he didn't give him a New Testament or anything. He didn't give him any scripture books. He didn't give him anything. He didn't have a prophetic word from the Lord or nothing except go home and your son liveth. And that man walked all the way back, wondering. Don't say he wasn't wondering. No, he was. He walked all the way back, but he had the courage to go just on the word. Just on the word. And, of course, he found out, as you read the story, you find out that his son was healed, and he was healed at the moment. He asked him, what time did it happen? And he was healed at that particular moment that Jesus said it. Another thing that I want you to get out of that, my point is, don't let your physical senses dictate what you believe. Because you must walk by faith, not by sight. Amen. And in Mark 11, you know it, but let me give you a point. Just out of one verse, I'm giving you some pointers here before I take you somewhere, okay? In Mark 11, everybody knows this verse, at least you should. Mark 11, 24 says, therefore, I say unto you, what things soever you desire, when you pray, believe that you receive them and you shall have them. That's a remarkable verse. It puts all of it on you. And it says it again. Look at it. It said, well, you don't even have to go there. But anyway, what things soever you desire. Well, I desire healing. That's what we're here for tonight. Healing. We desire healing. I desire healing. Whatsoever things you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them and you shall have them. So that you have to predetermine that when I pray, I'm going to get this. Amen. When you pray, not when I pray, when you pray. Right. When you pray. When you pray. So what can we get out of that? What you have to believe before you get it. Amen. You got to believe you got it before you get it. Amen. And you believe you got it before you get it, then you go get it. Amen. But you got to believe that you have it before you have it. And then, of course, you will have it. Now, so two things I've already told you, two short things that have major implications for you tonight. Major implications. One is walk by faith, not by sight, which is don't let your physical senses or your feelings determine what you believe. Everybody in here knows that. No. Everybody in here has heard that. Everybody in here has heard that. Don't let how you feel determine how big your God is. Okay. Now, the other thing is Proverbs 3:5, and I'll read it to you. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding. Do not lean back on what you think or how you reason. You've got to believe the Lord to bring His word to pass in your life. You have to believe the Lord. Do not let your thinking overrule God's thinking. If God said, don't pay attention to your own thinking, believe what He said, then when all hell tries to tell you this don't work, and all hell tries to tell you out loud that this is what the doctor says, this is what so-and-so said, this is what your body is screaming, you still have a decision to make. All of us. What you believe in. Said, well, I'm trying to believe. No, you don't try. Amen. Just make a decision. Amen. It doesn't mean it goes away immediately. It doesn't mean that. But it means you're on the way to recovery. Amen. Believers shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. And it's not they might recover, they shall recover. It didn't say anything about somebody big and famous laying hands on you. Thank God, because I'm not that. But I mean, it doesn't say that. It could be the person sitting right beside you, anybody, anywhere, who believes Jesus is the Son of God and are born again, can lay hands on you, and you should be moving into recovery. Amen. Now, I'm just quoting Bible. So I've given you three principles. One, what was it? Do you remember? Don't let your physical senses tell you what's happening to you. Number two, you have to believe before you get it. You got to believe that God has given you what you desire before you ever get it. What does that mean? You got to believe God's telling the truth. You got to believe God's not a man that He should lie. You got to believe that God will do, if you can find it in the book, amen, that God did it and God said it, you can take it to the bank. And then we believe that He says, don't let your natural reasoning, this is running my family for years, they've all had it for years, I've had it for years, this is the way it goes, nothing is changing, this is the way it is. That is not God talking. What is it? We need healing, so He sent His word and healed me. By the stripes of Jesus, I am healed. I'm just quoting scripture, that's all I'm doing. I'm not taking time to take you to it. I'm quoting scripture. You need to get a scripture book. That's what you need. We have a wonderful one. And you need to turn the scripture book, and it even gives a prayer for you. Turn the scripture book, particularly find it on healing. Find a scripture on healing and begin to read those scriptures until one of them jumps out at you. But thank you. This, here we go. The magnificent word of the Lord. I know this person. This is a good book. Find the healing one for me, Bill, the pages. But what I'm saying is, I'm telling you how to do it. You go to that scripture. I'm trying to make it easy for you. You go to that. You find out what all it says about healing. There's a whole page in here, two or three of them, on healing. And you need healing. You begin to go down the list until one of them jumps out at you. Amen. Now, these words, these are not promises. Amen. So we didn't name it promises. These are facts. Amen. And I'm going to tell you about that in a minute, okay? These are truths. Amen. These are not promises. This is not something that God says, if you do so-and-so, you'll get it. These are what God has said. Healing is not a promise. Healing is a done fact. Healing is a fact. It is a fact. It is not a promise. Something that He's already done for you. Something that's past tense. Yes. By His stripes you are healed. Is a done deal. Yes. So we're not here tonight to get poor God to work for us. Right. We're here to try to believe Him. Amen. And I'm trying to convince you to believe what God says. See, a promise tells you about something that's going to happen. I know the little books are called promise books. I know that. I know that. And there are a lot of things in the Bible that are promises. And that's true. Healing's not a promise. Healing is a fact. And it talks about something you've already received. It's already happening. So by Jesus' stripes, you already are healed. Now, we come down to the question. Well, if that's so, how come I don't know it? Or maybe we should say, how come I don't experience it? Or why am I having such difficulties? We'll talk to you about that. In Isaiah 26:3, it says, you will keep him in perfect peace. The Lord will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is fixed on him. You keep your mind, listen carefully, short and sweet. You keep your mind fixed on the Lord and you're going to have peace. John 14:27 says, my peace I continually give to you. I said, everything's going to be all right. Now, how can I make such a statement? Everything's going to be all right. Satan is trying to steal your purpose and your identity. If you don't have any peace, you're not going to hold on to it. If you don't have peace, you're not going to work and operate in faith. I'm going to show you so clearly here that this is where a lot of our problem is tonight. If I can get you to see this and move into this, you should receive a lot of things from the Lord tonight. The peace of God will stabilize you. When you have peace and your heart's settled and you aren't just beside yourself, but you have peace, then you can receive. If you don't have peace, you won't receive. When you get to the place that you can believe, we're talking about healing. When you get to the place, it's going to be all right. My God's going to take care of me. He is going to turn this thing around for me. He's going to help me see and help me by when I choose to believe him. So we're still back to what you're going to believe. Because you have to believe it. You are a spirit, you have a soul, and you live in a body. I'm talking to your spirit tonight. If I do not reach your spirit, you will not be helped. If I just lodge into your mind somewhere, and somewhere that you, because you've heard it all your life, or you can quote the scripture better than I can, and that's all you know how to do, but you don't have a genuine rest in God, I am then only speaking to your soulish area. And your soulish area won't do anything but confuse you. I have to get to your spirit. We have to go to the part of you that's like God is spirit. You're born again in his image. Your spirit has been invaded by the Holy Spirit when you accepted Jesus. I'm talking to your spirit man. Spirit to spirit. I'm telling you what. And when I read this word, spirit to spirit. This is not the word of man. God's fixing to talk to you. God wrote this book. These are God words. If you can understand that your spirit has the power. Your spirit has the power to push out that which is not of God. If you'll let the spirit man take supremacy. If you'll grab hold of who you are in Christ Jesus. And know that God is in you and get the peace that passes understanding. That you know he will not forsake you. He will not leave you. He will fulfill what he brought you here to do. Don't let go of your destiny. turn it loose. Make up your mind. Sitting there tonight, make up your mind. You know, this thing's going. This thing will not take me down. This will not kill me. It will not steal from me. It will not make me be a nothing. I am a somebody in Christ Jesus. And hell will be sorry ever tried to take me out. And all these things are but names. So it is your spirit man that is going to hear these words. And if your spirit man, if you'll get your mind clean, if you're determined right now, I'm going to hear what God has to say to me. Because if you hear it, it will knock out those things which are not of God in your life. Amen. What is not of God has no right to be there. I don't care how old you are, how pretty you are, how ugly you are, how broke you are, or how rich you are. Everything's going to be all right. You got to get that mentality. This is going to work out. This is going to be all right. Everything's going to be all right. My God's going to make this. This is going to be all right. This is going to change. This is changing. God's word is pushing it out. Peace, rest, faith. Same word. All three of them work together. You got to have peace in order to have faith, in order to enter rest. If you can get in rest with where you are, what do I mean by that? You are so sure that no matter what hell has done, no matter what you've read, no matter what the report said, your God's going to do this for you. Amen. Not going to do it. He is doing it. Amen. He's waiting on you to release your faith. Well, how do you release your faith? With your mouth. Amen. The same way you release your disbelief. You release all of your unbelief with your mouth. Every bit of it. You crush it with your mouth. By saying what God said. And you begin to say it. And say it. And say, well, I'm saying it. I don't believe it. Well, keep saying it. You will believe it. Because that's the way you release your faith. For we are made, and verse 14, we are made partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end. Hang on to it. Hang on to what God has done in you. Listen to me. God's in you. He's a healer in you. We're not trying to get a healer. We're not, oh, Jesus, come as the healer, come as. If he's in you, he's the healer. There is but one healer. The world only knows how to patch you up. Thank God for it. Jesus is the healer. Jesus is the healer. Stay on with me. While it is said, verse 15, while it is said today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts. In other words, don't get in disbelief. As in the provocation. For some, when they had heard, did provoke, howbeit, not all that came out of it. Everybody didn't provoke the Lord, but the majority did. By unbelief. The provoke is they did not believe. So how do you provoke God? Don't believe. Let me say it to you again. How do you provoke God? Oh, God can't be provoked. Oh, yes, he can. Unbelief. Unbelief. All right, stay with me. But with whom was he grieved 40 years? Was it not with them that had sinned, whose carcasses fell in the wilderness? All right, what is sin? Unbelief. Those who did not believe. If they did not believe, they sinned.
Amen.
Are you with me?
Yes.
Not believing is a sin. Not believing God. Let's go on. And to whom swore he that they should not enter into his rest? Who is it then that's not going to be able to rest in him? Those who didn't believe. Do you understand you got to rest? Do you understand that tonight you've got to get at a rest? You've got to be assured. You've got to quit the struggle. You got to stop the struggle. You got to stop the begging. You got to stop begging. You got to stop getting everybody in the world to pray for you. You just got to believe that God so loved you, He wants you well. He wants you well. He wants you in all of your beauty. He wants you to be the rose in the garden. Well, how come He let me be sick? He didn't let you be sick. There's so many things in this world that happens to all of us, but He's given us the ability to overcome.
Amen.
We can't let whatever's happening to us be bigger than the God in us. I don't care what it is. I have the C word. They say I have cancer. Well, just because they said it doesn't mean you have to take it. Don't ever call it yours. Don't make it your diabetes, your cancer. Don't possess it. Don't give it a key to your dining room. Don't welcome it into your waiting room. Don't say, come on in, been expecting you. Got a place for you over here. Everybody in my family died with the same thing. Guess I'll go too. You better run it out of the house. Let's keep going. Verse 4 of chapter 4. Let us therefore fear lest a promise being left us of entering into His rest. Any of you should seem to come short of it. In case you come short of it, listen. We got to rest. Look at your neighbor and say, I got to rest in this. Or what do you have to rest in? I've got to rest in the fact that God's going to take care of me. I've got to rest in the fact I've got to have peace. I've got to rest. I've got to know this is going to be all right. I've got to rest that God is who He said He is. He did what He said He would do. I have to rest in it. Look at your neighbor and say, I've got to rest in this. I've got to sleep. I got to be at peace. I've got to rest in it. Amen. For unto us was the gospel preached. What is the gospel? The good news. What's the good news? Preaching, teaching, healing. For unto us was the gospel preached, as well as unto them. But the word preached didn't profit them. The word preached didn't help them. We're here tonight. The word that's been preached to us has not helped some of us. Because it's not been mixed with faith. You heard it. You heard it. But you weren't at peace enough to believe it. And it takes peace and faith to bring the rest. Are you following me? Praise the name of the Lord. See, when you fail in faith, belief, trust, and you fail to be persuaded, you cannot have peace.
Amen.
Come on, we'll show it right here in front of your face. For we which have believed do enter into His rest. If I believe, I'm going to rest in it.
Amen.
I'm going to rest that I'm going to heaven because I'm believing it now.
Amen.
How many are resting in the fact you're going to heaven? I'm resting in the fact that I'm going to heaven. I rest in the fact that my sins are forgiven. Because if I didn't believe my sins are forgiven, I would be a wreck. I'd be a basket case. But I believe that my sins are forgiven, that God has forgiven me. So I'm at peace about that. I can totally rest about that. I can rest about that. No, I'm not going to be haunted about my sins. No. They're under the blood. They're under the blood.
Amen.
Why? Why can I be at peace? I believed.
Amen.
The same is true with healing.
Amen.
When I truly believe that by His stripes I'm healed, when I truly believe that He's not mad with me, that He's not trying to teach me something through this sickness, that is dumb. The Bible doesn't say that. It's a lie. The Bible doesn't teach that. You need to go with the Bible. They preach it in my church. Well, hold the Bible up to them. I can tell you whether they believe in healing at your church or not. Is there a bottle of oil on the platform? Is there not? They don't believe in anointing with oil, praying for the sick. Call for the elders of the church.
Amen.
Hello? Well, I mean, I believe in it, but I don't have to go to a church that really believes in healing. Let me tell you something. In this day and age, yes, you do. Time is too short. Hell is disturbing all the churches. Churches are walking away from the Word of God. They are not believing the Word of God. You better find a company of believers who believe the Word. All of the Word. And stay with it. As I have sworn in my wrath, if they shall enter into my rest, although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. You've been healed from the foundation of the world. How long have I been healed? Forever. From the beginning. For he spake in a certain place on the seventh day on this verse, wise, and God did rest the seventh day from all his works. And in this place again it shall, if they shall enter into my rest. Verse 6 of chapter 4. Seeing therefore it remaineth that some must enter therein, and they to whom it was first preached enter not because of unbelief. They could not be persuaded. That's what that word really says. They could not be persuaded to believe. Now, I'm doing everything in my power to persuade you tonight. I'm trying to go directly to your spirit to persuade you. There's nothing in your life to keep you except unbelief from receiving. You're hunting something that's already been given. You're going after praying, please. Don't misunderstand me. We all do it because that's what the flesh does. And that's what your natural mind does. When you can't see it and you can't feel it and the pain's killing you, that's what you end up doing. But somewhere, God's bigger than this. This is going to be all right. Set a platform. This is going to be all right. Look at your neighbor and say, everything's going to be all right. Hallelujah. Verse 9. There remaineth therefore a rest to the people of God. For he that is entered into his rest, he also has ceased from his own works, as God did from his. When you start resting, you will quit striving. And you will start praising. Praising. Let us labor, therefore, to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief. Let's make sure we believe God. For the word of God is quick, powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow, and it's a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. The word of God. The Word of God. The Word of God. See, God already has every answer to every question you have. Who do we need? Him. We need Jesus. That's who we need. And we have the power to choose to trust in God. You got to get past the whys. Because when we get on whys, I can tell you I've walked it many a time. When you get on wise, you become a victim. And when you get on wise, it's an invalid question. And it makes you an invalid. What does this mean? What must I do? That's what we should be asking. What does this mean? What is it I must do? Lord, what is it? What is it you're trying to say to me? What is it I must do? Don't let circumstances use you. Change how you see it. Run to Jesus. Don't hunt a prophetic word. Run to Him. His peace will give you vision, clear vision, vision of Him. Peace is critical to your spiritual health, your mental health, and your physical health. Peace, rest. Don't be like those who did not believe. Don't be like those who didn't believe. He has given us the power to believe. We can choose to believe. He may not do it the way you want it done. It doesn't matter how He does it. Just, I believe you're going to do it. You're going to do it. I choose to believe you're working in my body. I choose to believe I'm in recovery. Hands have been laid on me. I'm in recovery. And hell, you will not take my life. You will not make me an invalid. You will not steal from me my destiny and my purpose. You will not do that. I won't let you do that, because I will praise God, and I will praise God, and I will praise God. And you will never make me not praise Him. I will praise Him, and 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 I will praise Him. I will praise Him. He's worthy of all my praise. I will praise Him. There's a song, and if I were a singer, I'd sing it to you. But the words are these. This house of clay is but a prison. Bars of bones over my soul. But the doors of clay are going to burst wide open when the angels come to set my spirit free. I'll take my flight like a mighty eagle when the hills of home start calling me. I've seen loved ones over there. Tears are gone. Their hearts are free. And from the throng, Jesus beckons me. The hills of home, they call me. And this house of clay, it's a prison. What your body is, this is but a prison. And my bones, they're over my soul. They're covering me. But one day, the door of clay is going to bust wide open, honey. When the angel comes to set my spirit free. I'll take my flight. I'll be like a mighty eagle when the hills of home start calling me. The hills of home will call every single one of us one day. And this house of clay that you think is so precious, you're going to bust wide out of it. And the bones that are giving you such trouble, they're bars around you. And when the angel comes and sets you free, I'm telling you with everything in me, you're going to take a flight like a mighty eagle. Nothing can hold you. Nothing can keep you. Nothing can hold you down. Don't forget who you are. You carry Him. You house Him. He's in you. Maybe the clay's holding you now. Maybe the bones have aching and carrying on. But the day's coming. Yeah. It's coming. You're going to bust out of those things. Amen. And you won't have to deal with that anymore. Yeah. Ever again. Amen. But you can start breathing in and taking in the mighty eagle approach just by letting your spirit begin to soar inside of you. Because God lives inside of you. He's not little. He's not small. He's not sick. He's big and mighty. And it's just clay and it's just bones. Give him room to burst and push that stuff aside. That who you really are can be seen. And somebody can know who you are. Don't bow to the devil's lie. You're free, my friend. You're healed. And we're going to agree and hold that with you. And hold that with you. So, Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we come to you tonight free. We need to rest. We need to rest. We need to be at peace that you haven't left us, forgotten about us, that you aren't ashamed of us, that you are embarrassed of us. Forgive us for even thinking such terrible things. Those kind of things would never, ever come out of your mouth. You would never say anything but wondrous things over your beloved disciples. You honor them. You honor us. You want us to show forth your glory and your might. We come against the lies of hell. We break their power over us. Those who think they can't get up, get up. Those who think they can't walk, walk. Those who think that they have been absolutely invaded and encapsulated by the diseases of this world, burst out of it. Take your stand. Do it. Believe it. Rise up and be healed in Jesus' name. Be healed in Jesus' name. Rest in him. Find peace in him. Be not afraid. He won't leave you. He won't forsake you. He's not in the dying business. He's in the living business. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Let's just praise him. And 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 praise him. Lord, let your peace be over this congregation. Give people power and strength to trust you and step out and do what they couldn't do before they came in here. That'll put action to their faith. Encourage them. Take all fear away. All fear be gone. And we thank you, Lord Jesus. We praise you. Church, praise him. We praise him. We praise him. We praise him. Let's lift our hands to him. Let's lift our hands to him. That's such a higher way of praising. Praise him, praise him, praise him. Praise him, praise him, praise him. Praise him, praise him. Praise him, praise him. Praise him, praise him, praise him. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord God.